text which are the governance arrangements for this committee and how it interacts with the other relevant committees. I should just say, because I think it's important to this committee going forward, that one of the big differences between this committee and the previous PCM committee is that we've taken away the theme committee financial oversight and put it back into those theme committees, which is, I think, alongside the suggestions that came out of some of the Ofsted comments in relation to children's services as applied to the council more widely. And therefore, this change has been made to reflect that. And therefore, what this committee is intended to do, picking up some of the things which Mr. Dick said, is to actually scrutinise the overall financial performance of the council. And we've got later on a suggestion as to how future reporting will be done to this committee so that we can see the heads that we will be reporting against to try and achieve that result. And we've also attempted to lay out in this paper what policy and resources is responsible for, what this committee is responsible for, and how the theme committees fit into that. Now, I recognise that when we're going through papers generally, it is inevitable that some matters in relation to theme committees come up. Because that is not within our mandate, what I have asked governance to do is to collect those comments and pass them to the chairs of the relevant theme committees so they don't get lost. And I hope that that will be acceptable to committee members as a way of dealing with that particular issue. But I think what I should do with this report following that introduction is open it to questions and comment. Councillor Brown.
Thank you. 1.2 on page 6, there's undertaking deep dives to review specific issues. I want to know if that's similar to calling something in, as I'd very much like to call in the Mosaic IT contract implementation.
The answer is we will take that under advisement, and we will, at the end of the meeting, we can discuss whether or not we have done justice to your concern.
I think it's a bit wider than that, because there's just a general issue of whether or not we can call in things that we're concerned about going on in the committees.
So, figure one attempts to set out that theme committees can make referrals to this committee, whose expertise broadly is in financial performance and specific contractual issues and contractual performance. Equally, this committee can make referrals to theme committees. I wouldn't necessarily term it as a call-in to this particular committee.
No, that's why I'm asking the question. Because if we see that there's a financial implication that this committee ought to be looking at, but the theme committee hasn't itself volunteered that, what's the mechanism for us being able to say that the thing should come to this committee?
Yes, I mean, this committee can have members' items. I mean, there were no members' items on this occasion, but there's absolutely no reason why, if you are concerned about things, you can't bring it as a member's item, and then we will take it as such.
So we'll do it through a member's item.
I mean, so recognising that we may end up with the paradox of members' items on blue papers on certain issues, if we wish to explore them in detail.
Yeah.
Do we have any other comments on this paper, or are people prepared to take this as a framework to be working with the time being? In which case, the officer recommendations are that the committee is asked to approve the full paper to be considered by the committee on a regular basis, and the committee is asked to note the committee's relationship to the broader performance and risk reporting framework. Is that acceptable? Thank you. Right. We now move to the financial monitoring report outturn, and I think probably given that this is a complex report with many sections, that probably the best thing to do is to work through it section by section, and to take any comments that people have, ask officers to try and deal with any comments that they can, and see where we get to. So if we start with the revenue outturn, do you have any questions?
A question and then a statement. The question first relates to 1.2.2 and this would be to the Director of Finance, I think. It says there that the Director of Finance, that the drawdowns of the fund reserves were approved as part of the year-end closure process. Does that mean that they were going on throughout the year without proper approval?
No, it doesn't mean that. No, it just means that a lot of requests come at the year end, and there was a big exercise that was involving myself in relation to requests to draw down from reserves. So we fundamentally do that year end. If there were requests earlier in the year, then they would have been dealt with then. But it tends to be part of the year end process.
If it's part of the year end process, does that mean it's already been spent and you're asking retrospectively? Or it's already been committed
in asking to draw down? It's not a question of being spent, it's a contribution from reserves to the financial position at the year end. So it won't impact necessarily on whether somebody has the approved to spend, it might do.
But that means they've already overspent and they're asking for drawdown to offset the overspend, isn't it?
It could mean that, yes.
It's not very good, is it?
I don't know.
We need to distinguish between classes of overspend. If you're in adult services, then we know there are cost pressures. And we know that we are fulfilling our statutory obligations. And that to some extent, if people require services that it is necessary to provide, then they will be provided. And at the end of the year, there will be a reconciliation of the total expenditure. There may be a need to recognise an overspend, and it may not become apparent until the end of the year as to exactly what the scale of that overspend is. On the other hand, there are items such as the ones that we've just been talking about, which is this £4.5 million matter, which needed to resolve where the Section 151 officer concluded that it needed to be written off. It was not a current year item, and I believe it was reserves were used to deal with that. And therefore, that was not expenditure which had even occurred during the year. So each of these items will in fact be different.
I appreciate that, but you're smoothing over a crack here, aren't you? You know very well that not to have known that this overspend was being accruing is not to do it. And then at year end, to have to bail out is not a satisfactory way of running your council. And in fact, you know, the proposal's going to PNR, I think, recognising that and looking for a new structure. But I think, given we're talking about that as account, we do need to record that we feel it's been very unsatisfactory and that the financial controls have been not before. Anyway, I'd like to go on to the overspend, which is top of page 15. The total overspend, as I read it there, is over is 21.148 million because that includes reserves that were built into the budget in the first place, which seems a bit naughty, reserves that were built into the budget in the first place, plus drawdown on reserves, which were approved at the year end, plus money that is got to be rolled over into next year because departments have got overspend on their budgets. And the total's coming to 21.148 million. Is that right? And does it include the reference to RE? On section 12118, where it says there's about £1 million variance that looks as the way I read that was that that was going to be pushed into next year, into 18-19 as well.
Any question, Chair? I'm trying to go through it with most of you. So there's no bailing out per se, because what's happening is here is an attempt to demonstrate a transparent way, which I think I mentioned this to Mr. before, you didn't have. So you can see the gross overspend in Table 1.
I'm not saying
thank you, Councillor. You can see in Table 1 that gross overspend is £13.5 million. That is the position, and you can transparently see that. Now, the only thing that you might draw to that, to my attention and others, is the planned reserve. Now, when you refer to something as naughty and I shook my head, that's because the council approved the planned drawdown of those reserves in its medium-term financial strategy decision. So that's entirely appropriate if council choose to do that in advance of the financial year to balance the position. As to your CFO, whoever that is in the future, ought to be making a recommendation to you about when the medium-term financial strategy is approved and that sort of action is taken. But what I can say to you now, we're really, in this report, reminding colleague councillors that that decision was taken formally as part of the agreement for the medium-term financial plan in the previous February. So I think that's an entirely appropriate thing to do. If you then accept that that's a plan to draw down a reserve, which I think I've demonstrated is, the £13.5 million clearly wasn't planned, and that is the gross overspend. If you add that £13.5 million to the plan to use 7.669, that shows that the council's had to draw down £21 million from its reserves when it was only planning to draw down 7.7. So in the Policy and Resources Committee report, I'm drawing attention to the fact that the £21 million drawdown isn't really sustainable for the council going forward. I'm hoping that members will treat that very seriously in terms of future financial planning. I hope that helps.
Thank you very much. Would you agree that
Councillor
Hall has this is not a question for you, this is a question for the Chair, because in the sense it's political. Would you agree that it's completely unacceptable for us to be from the council that is spending well above the budget every year like this?
The answer is I would use the words that we used in the answers to the questions. This is clearly not sustainable, and action has to be taken to stop it. Councillor Marshall.
Councillor V used the word naughty. She was actually being very naughty herself. Because when she talked about the use of reserves, she knows full well that in the 2016-17 budget, the Labour shadow budget would have included the use of reserves. She also knows that in 1994 the Labour Liberal Council received huge reserves from the Hogan administration. They ran them down dramatically, so that when Councillor Finn has presented the budget, he inherited a black hole and the council tax has gone up, I think, 20%. She's just being very naughty. She should look at the history and realise that if there had been a Labour council, they would have used reserves as well.
Thank you, Chair. Whilst we're talking about very naughty behaviour. Can we just be clear with regards to revenues that the medium term financial strategy includes plans to increase the council tax by the maximum amount permitted? Is that right?
I would ask Section 1, Paragraph 2
to confirm. Yeah. The current financial strategy looking forward includes a 3% rise year on year.
So what you're... I mean, that's very interesting, because I seem to read a few months ago certain things about the council taxes rising under potential Labour administration. It seems like that's about to happen anyway, doesn't it?
We're having this discussion. What I would point out is that council tax is cumulatively circa, I use that advisedly, 20% lower than it would have been if the maximum rate had been applied.
It's done to our services.
Year on year on year. And that will continue to be the case. And therefore, the fact is that the residents of Barnet have benefited, as they always, every survey that we do demonstrates that they value the lower council tax higher than almost anything else which they value. Therefore, we are absolutely clear that the policies that we have pursued to council tax as low
you've wasted
as possible,
all our money on two
as
contracts
low as possible,
needing.
Please, as low as possible, are exactly what the residents of Barking want. Let us move on.
But just to be clear, for the remainder of this term, you are raising the council tax by the maximum allowable rate. So you've U-turned and kept your election promises.
That is not the medium-term financial strategy, which was approved by council before the election, included those assumptions. Nothing has changed since that date. And they are merely assumptions at this stage. Council tax is not increased until every year it is considered in the context of the available resources in that year.
But I would make the point,
then we're going to move on, because we have a lot to cover, that the medium-term financial strategy was set significantly earlier in the year, and those assumptions were baked into it. Do we have any other comments on this section of this report?
Page
15.
Can I ask on page 17? It's nothing controversial. It says about the building management, safe management. The number of buildings has gone up from 5 to 95. Is there some explanation on that?
Yes. I think that this, perhaps officers can comment further. But my understanding is that there was a discussion about what the contract actually required to be managed. And that there was an original view that the contract applied to only 5 buildings, whereas I think it has now been agreed that the contract will in fact cover a much larger number of buildings. But that's the major director would like to comment.
Can I just check? Does that include libraries? Overruns relating to overspends in libraries don't they refer to the estate department? So.
This is a different issue that you're describing. This you describe about the income targets for the library service and 500,000 income targets. That's not how this issue, which is about the number of buildings in the non-civic estate, which is being serviced on this issue.
It looks like 1 million there. building?
I think the point Kevin's making is about the distinction between underlying pressures which continues year on year on one-off items.
Yeah, I appreciate one, that. There's always one.
And the one that you're item that you're describing is a one-off item as well. Yeah.
Do we have any other questions on this section?
Yeah, that's great. That's good. Thank you. Let us ask, based on 1.2.6 and 1.2.8, social housing seems to have increased by 18% from FY17, and then the weekly cost has increased by 6%. Is that increase being balanced by the 3% social increase in council tax?
So it's not completely dealt with by the precept rise, because in the current year, 18-19, adult services is still forecasting an overspend position.
Do we have any other questions on this section?
On page 21.2.23, the places that what's been put in place to manage the position include a vacancy freeze. What's the impact of this on service users, and what will be the follow-on impact of this, say, on financial or management positions in the council?
My understanding is that the various measures that have been put in place are being actively managed by chief officers to ensure that they don't do damage to services, but perhaps between the commercial director and the section 151 officer, they'd like to take a question.
So obviously that all of the vacancies and agency staff that are now coming to the newly established panel, the service chief officer is there, the discussions are being had on in relation to whether there would be undue pressure on the service, and indeed frontline social work posts are excluded from this arrangement. So we're trying, I think, as a panel, to get that balance right between whether or not there'd be a service impact, and at the same time trying to work hard to keep the budget within its available envelope.
1.2.21, there's a reference to the result of run rate activity. Could you just explain what that is, please? I think that's
perhaps it's a bit jargony, but it just means like a trend of the spend going through.
Thank you, Chair. So what you're saying is that at the moment we're already predicting for the next year there's going to be £11 million over spend straight off the bat. You almost call that a sort of a second thing.
Councillor Bean has already alluded to this, that there is inevitably carryover. If you overspend in 1 year and that overspend is ongoing overspend, then there will be additional pressure in the following year. What this section of the paper attempts to do is to explain what, taking account of the one-off items, that ongoing overspend pressure is. So what it does is attempt to knock back from the 21 or a higher number that Councillor Bean was talking about, adjusting for one-off items, to come to the 11 million as an ongoing pressure which will require additional cost reductions. Then, further along in the paper, it suggests that in the next paragraph, 1.2.22, that of that 11 million, 1.5 million has been found already, and that leaves an ongoing pressure of 9.5 million, which is the 9.5 million that was previously referred to in the paper.
My reading was that the 11 million was being compared with the 7.885 million in Table 1 that was going forward. So what's the increase compared with what it was going to be? How much has it gone up? Has it gone up by 11 million or was there another figure and then it's gone up to 11
million? It's exactly as Councillor Zinkin outlined. So the forecast for the council at the moment is a gross pressure of £11 million. That is the position that has had now. So we've taken out the impacts of one-offs from the previous previous year. We factored in any one-offs that might be the case this year and had a look at underlying pressures looking forward. So paragraph 1.2.24 tries to summarise what we're trying to explain to the committee here. So after a mitigation of 1.5 million, as Councillor Dinkin says, brings us down to 9.5 million, but that, remember, is after the planned use of reserves. And we discussed planned use of reserves earlier. So your comparison in terms of last financial year and this financial year is 13.5 compared to 21.1. And that is our assessment of the current position. Now we are working, offices are working hard to ensure that we don't have to draw down another 13.5 this year. And that's the work that we have to do collectively.
And do you think the 1.5 million is up? You said it's in the bank, but in here it doesn't. It says it's anticipated an additional income will be achieved. So how secure is that 1.5 million in additional income?
We've just got to do some work to make sure it is okay. So like anything else, we are forecasting at this point in time. And we will continue to forecast through the year. And you know, we'll be able to bring you up to speed as those forecasts change. I'm rather hoping that you'll see that number go down. You know, there's no guarantee to that. We don't know what we don't know. And you know, I always try and remind members that these are forecasts. At this point in time, it's a forecast.
So we're going to see another 9.5 million in cuts?
Yes. The answer is 9.5 million is being sought, and that can either come from one or two places, one of which is income generation, and the other of which is cost reduction. So the answer is no, it doesn't all have to come from cuts, but it has to come from either income generation or cost reduction.
What does cost reduction mean?
Cuts.
Income
generation into account by knocking 1.5 off the 11.
Surcharge accounts.
Cost reduction is cuts.
Can we move the series to section? I'm sorry.
No, sorry, I wanted to ask about dedicated schools grant as well.
Dedicated schools grant.
Yeah, about section 1.2.27. I think there's something funny in the numbers there. A transfer from reserves of 3.724. That wasn't reserves, was it? Wasn't that the total? Outside. Those figures don't add up. The total of the current reserves are 1.831. You're transferring from reserves 3.724. In my view, that gives you a negative, but you've still got 500,000 left, so I don't get what's going on there.
I think the numbers add up wrong. I don't think they want. I think that you're misreading the first sentence. I think that the DS3 budget is due to the use of DSG reserves, which open for 1.83 million. The 1.831 million is what was used for the former previous year stretch. I think it's just an example. I'm just reading the English. I apologise for the fact that it can be used both ways.
In the DSG balance, it should be on the page, credit card.
Please use the mic.
I think it's just a misreading for the English. Right, moving on.
But it just means there's not anything left in the DSG reserves, there's half a million left.
There's half a million left.
I'm taking 3.7 million out this year.
Please use the mic.
Sorry, we're taking 3.7 million out this year and we've only got half a million left. What's going to happen next year?
Well, we can't go below the zero balance.
Yes, I think we need to look at that in terms of understanding the scale of that budget, which is very large. So we need to look at that in terms of, if you look at table 4, in terms of the DSG table, which is a very significant budget. And therefore, I'm not saying that these grant movements are not important, but they are a very, very small proportion of a very large budget. We're talking about 3.7 million in a 209 million budget. So, contextually, it is important. Councillor Marshall.
schools and balances, how much do individual schools have in total of their balances?
I think that's a question we have to take under advisement. We can get back to you on that, if you would like. We then move to a paragraph on savings. Do we have any questions on